Today in our series of DocPlexus Cable interviews, we are honored to have with us Dr. Amitabh Banerjee. Dr. Banerjee is the professor and head of Department of Community Medicine at D.Y. Patil Medical College, Pune. He has served in the Indian Armed Force from 1975 to 2005 as an epidemiologist with the Mobile Epidemiological Team of the Armed Forces to help control pneumonia, hepatitis, typhoid, German measles, food poisoning and malaria in tribal pockets of India. Currently, he is the head of the department at Department of Community Medicine, D.Y. Patil Medical College, Pune. He has more than 100 publications to his credit in national and international journals. He has delivered several keynote addresses in national and international conferences as an accredited speaker on the panel of Maharashtra Medical Council. He is also associated with Surin University, Thailand as a research and publications advisor. Thank you so much, Dr. Banerjee, for joining us. So, can you please elaborate on the different ways in which communicable diseases are transmitted?
Mainly, there are three methods. First is person-to-person contact, say by handshake, by coughing. Other is the water and food bond. And third is the vector bond. And besides that, sometimes it is by needles, sometimes mother-to-child transmissions like HIV, hepatitis B. So, they are basically related to hygiene, sanitation, particularly waterborne, foodborne, deforestations like vectors, climate change, it increases the density of vectors, population movements. So, these are the methods by which.
Can you please share your experience of working in tribal areas where people more believe in quacks than in medicine? So, how difficult was it to convince the tribal people to take medicines and follow hygiene practices for controlling the diseases or the outbreaks?
The tribal area, I have had two experiences. One was way back as a general duty medical officer. That was somewhere in the 1980s. I was working in Nagaland in the armed forces. We had to give medical cover to the civilian population. So, I was prescribing some medicine to a lady and she wasn't getting well. After some time, after the fifth or sixth visit, I found what she has done. We used to give that colorful tetracycline capsules, which was this yellow and red. So, she had made it into a necklace. She thought it's a bead and put it around her neck. And put it round her arm, thinking it is the charm which will cure. So then I realized she is not taking the medication, but she is putting it like they have this sort of a superstitious belief. So that was way back in 1980, probably that may not apply now. And other experience was a very highly malarious belt in central India, the Betul district. So there was lot of this tribals, they used to go for a lot of activities in the forest. It was surrounded by teak forest. Sometimes the activities were not very, illegal activities like cutting wood and other things. And there the malaria was a major problem. And most of the vectors in the tribal areas, they rest outdoors. So when they used to go outdoor, they were getting the malaria, they were coming back to their villages, and around it we had the Air Force station. All our security people who were doing night duties, malaria was being transmitted to them through this tribal reservoir. So it is sometimes their ignorance, sometimes their activities in the tribal areas. Other problem in tribal areas, particularly for malaria control and vector control, is that the health services cannot penetrate, because in most of the tribal areas there is a problem of myo problem or the naxalite problem, where the health services are not there. So these people form the reservoir of infection, and the mosquitoes are mostly outdoor. So malaria is a major problem. Of course, besides that, there are the malnutrition and child malnutrition and other problems are there. And there have been some successful model, you may be knowing about the Gajri-Choli project and other things, but these are on pockets only. But on the whole, they suffer from child malnutrition and malaria.
So, how successful has been the DOTS program in controlling tuberculosis in India, and what is the bottleneck in implementing such strategies in India?
So, DOTS implementation may not have been as good as the trial which was initially done. To establish DOTS, they quote some very trials which were done under ideal conditions. But in actual practice, in day-to-day practice, those ideal conditions are not difficult to conform to it. The laborers, they move out, the migrant population move out. There is a problem of drug resistance. And that way, I think it has not made any impact. In fact, none of the national program has made an impact, I mean, if you come to think of it.
So is it possible to design an epidemiological study when given unlimited resources in India?
Definitely, epidemiological study does not require too much of resources. It requires the coordination. You see, right from the peripheral health centers, primary health centers, from the sub-centers, the primary health centers, district hospitals, if you have a good system of disease notification, just count the diseases. That is epidemiology. And then you react to it if there is any unusual. The problem is we don't have the infrastructure covering the whole country. On paper, we have got primary health centers. Doctors are not there. Health workers are not there. So if those people are not there, and even a simple person can do the reporting. Basic doctor can do the reporting. But if they are not covered, the infrastructure is not there, we cannot have epidemiology.
So from an epidemiological point of view, do you think that the outbreak of Zika is associated with climatic changes and deforestation?
Yes, yes. All the zoonosis, most of the emerging communicable disease and re-emerging communicable disease, 70% are from animal origin. And when there is deforestation for development, particularly in developing countries, the animals lose their shelter and they spill over to the human. And there is an interface between animal and man. So these things are phenomena of this reduced forest cover and ecosystem, disturbing the ecosystem.
So do you think an online platform of doctors like DocPlexus can help raise awareness amongst the doctors about public health?
Definitely. Doctors, if they are made aware of public health, they can influence the policymakers, because doctors are respected in society. They can influence the policymakers, not only the policymakers, the politicians and the policymakers do not react until unless the people are, there is a people's movement. So doctors can do some sort of activism, involve the people, they in turn can influence the policymakers to look at the bigger issues.
Thank you so much, Dr. Amita, for speaking with us today.
Thank you.
To stay updated on our latest Scale videos and interviews, please follow us on Twitter, like us on our Facebook page, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Happy DocFlexing!